as many, I mean, plus today we're going to be talking about, we're going to be adding a little bit additional information onto that, including our first principle that affirms the inherent worth and dignity of every person, and our second principle that states the importance of justice, equity, and the compassion for human relations. To help us bring all those concepts together, we welcome Jan Boer, Director of UU Justice Florida's Climate Resiliency Ministry, and her presentation entitled Social Justice and Climate Change, an Inescapable Network of Mutuality. It's going to be a great morning, and we're really glad that you're here. Our announcements this morning, we want to make sure everybody knows that next week we will welcome back our good friend, Reverend Tiffany Sapp, who joins us every first Sunday of the month. And her service next week will be Awe is Calling. And that's a great title, and it's sure to be an awesome service. So please plan to join us next Sunday morning at 10:30 right here on Facebook and Zoom. And if you have any announcements that you would like to share with our community, please do email them to us early at info@uuofbaycounty.com. info@uuofbaycounty.com. And now, as we begin our service and time together, please join me in a deep breath in and out. And now let's welcome Janet Cross with the lighting of our chalice.
Good morning. You are welcome here no matter who you are, no matter where you come from, no matter what your background. You are welcome here to join us as we proclaim worth in our spiritual journeys. You are welcome to join us as we sing songs that uplift our very beings. You are welcome to join us in community as we learn, live, and love together. All are welcome as we worship that which gives us each meaning and value. No matter what you call this space, this hour, or this gathering of people, we worship as one body illuminated by the light of the chalice. I have to get my candle lit here. Y'all see? So please join me in reciting our covenant. Love is the spirit of this fellowship, and service is its way. This is our covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, to promote a sustainable world, and to help one another.
Thank you, Janet. Our first song this morning comes from the band Emma's Revolution. It's a popular group in the UU community that many of you may already be familiar with. Their powerful song, Our House is on Fire, was actually inspired by the brave young activist Greta Thunberg. In her 2019 address of the World Economic Forum, where she impressed upon world leaders the importance of taking action on the climate change now. Please enjoy.
Sooner, right now. on fire.
Well, that should have got everybody woke up this morning, huh? Our opening words come to us this morning from a short but awesome poem by Stephen Schick. There are times when oneness speaks so loudly, nothing else is heard. In those moments, I awaken, silenced by an immense sense of safety and assured by a knowledge of who I am and what I can do. So true, the power we feel individually when we all come together for one righteous cause. That same could be said about the strength that we draw individually from the fellowship of coming together in support of our joys and sorrows we experience in our lives. At this time, we pause for a moment to share the joys and concerns of our congregation. I invite you to state your share your joys and concerns in the chat here on Zoom, or you're welcome to do that in our Facebook comments live on our Facebook page, so that we can all celebrate or support you at this time. I have a few of myself here. I've noticed this morning that today is Cheryl Kellogg's 75th birthday. Join me in wishing her a great day. She is a great friend and fellow friend of this fellowship and many of you watching today. Bob Nixon also shared that his family is traveling overseas right at the moment and wishes you'd help him in hoping them for a safe and happy trip. And actually, I have a concern. My father was actually admitted in the hospital this week with encephalitis. It was kind of scary for a day or two, but he is now doing much better. And we hope to have him home in the next day or two. So we'll wrap up that concern with a good joy. And if, for all these spoken and unspoken shares, please hold these celebrations and sorrows in a silent prayer or meditation as we listen to the All Souls Virtual Choir sing Spirit of Life. Remember, if you'd like to share any of your joys and concerns during the service, please send them to us in early at info@uuofbaycounty.com. Many of the elements in today's service were created by the UU Ministry for Earth as part of their Spirit for Change worship service. Service elements that were made available specifically for congregations to use at the Earth Day services and celebrations like ours today. For those of you who are not familiar with the UU MFE, I'd like to share a short video on how they are serving our community and our principles.
The Unitarian Universalist Ministry for Earth is rooted in core values of faith and spirituality, environmental justice, partnership, and collective action. We are inspired to facilitate UU practices that honor and sustain the earth and all beings. We are ready to create climate justice, showing up in solidarity with Indigenous frontline communities and catalyzing a just transition to an ecological civilization through strengthening local climate commitments, advocating for a Green New Deal, and more. We are fortifying a powerful and united network of Unitarian Universalists working for Earth justice. Join us.
In appreciation for their support and ongoing work for Earth justice, I kindly ask that our offering today be committed to uplifting this ministry. If you're so moved to make a donation to the UU ministry, we'd like for you to share them with them directly. You can do so by donating at www.uumfe.org. The Prime Minister of India, Narendra Modi, said on the issue of climate change, "Ethics and equity are the core debate on climate change. The debate has to move from climate change to climate justice." To talk more about climate justice and how it relates to our social justice efforts, I'm honored to introduce Jan Boer to our congregation. Again, Jan is the director of the UU Florida Justice's Climate Resiliency Ministry. She works in low-income communities of color to provide technical assistance and mentorship outstanding community leaders engaged in justice and equity issues that impact the health of the well-being of their residents. And she joins us today from her home in Davenport, Florida. Jan, we welcome you and thank you for being with us this morning.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here. I would like to share with you some, I know you have wonderful social justice warriors at your fellowship, and I'm actually in awe of some of their work. And what I'd like to do is share with you the trajectory from just thinking about climate change in terms of science to responding to the urgent need to assist those people, support those people who are on the front lines of climate change in low-income communities of color that we are working in. And one of them, of course, is yours. I've titled this Social Justice and Climate Change, an Inescapable Network of Mutuality. And the same network of mutuality that we find ourselves in a pandemic is the same network of mutuality that we're finding with climate change and is our interconnected web. So I would like to just begin with saying that the work that I am doing with Unitarian Universalist Justice for Florida is centered on working with people. It's climate resilience, and climate resilience has to do with every person and every person's ability to be resilient in the face of climate change. And every person has a fundamental right to life and a right to those things that are required for human decency. And we have to protect both those human and those civil rights in the face of climate change. So I'm going to take you back a few years to where we used to talk as our main challenge was educating people about science and getting people to use the words climate change. And so at that time, as now, as we continue to educate, we have to talk about the fact that We have greenhouse gases, that people are contributing to the emission of greenhouse gases, and that as these greenhouse gases accumulate in our atmosphere, the heat that's coming into the envelope is being withheld and held in the earth. And so not only water vapor, carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, and ozone getting trapped in the upper atmosphere, but as that is occurring, it is causing, that accumulation is causing a great rise. And we know that in the past 420,000 years before we had people that were doing their anthropomorphic additions to carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, it was moving along up and down in a kind of a regular oscillation, and that we have broken out to the upside. We've exceeded the 350 that 350.org had wanted us to try to maintain. And those of us who engaged early were working toward that, but of course we have passed through that ceiling. So what has happened is that the effects of our fabric of life on the planet is hugely affected at this point by climate change. And so we have moved from the area and embrace what has been done before, and we stand on the shoulders of those who have come before us, but we are now turning our efforts to looking at what those greenhouse gas concentrations and their rising temperatures that go with them mean for people. What does it mean for people that we have heat waves, and who is most affected and who is disproportionately affected? So the people who are at risk when we have peaks in heat and we have heat waves are the elderly, the very young, the obese, existing cardiac patients, people who work outside, people who play and exercise outside. And so we are concerned then about heat stress. We're concerned about heat stroke. We're concerned about cardiac disease and increased violence that occurs with this. And so when we are talking about heat waves, the air becomes stagnant and it traps emitted pollutants. And when the heat rises, so do ozone levels. And that's a chemical pollutant that results when we have nitrogen oxides and the volatile organic compounds and oxygen interacting close to the earth. And so those communities that have been environmental justice communities that have many pollutants associated with the traffic that has been directed through their neighborhoods, those that have lost the NIMBY battle because they did not have the power in their communities to work against having industry and changes of zoning that pushed industry into their neighborhood. These are the people we are seeing hugely affected by these heat waves. Also, the infrastructure in many of these communities has been so degraded by the lack of investment in these low-income communities that these are often the places that have the power off first and the power back on last. So this is where we see many people in low-income communities of color carrying people from the upper levels of housing units that have a lot of heat concentrated in the upper floors, carrying people down on their backs because no, they have not yet put generators on the elevators so that people can come down in an emergency. We see many problems like this in the urban environments. I'll talk to you about that particularly in a moment. Another thing that happens, as I said, is the concentration of these pollutants close to the ground that occurs, this reduced air quality. When we have changes in zoning that move even light industry that has a lot of delivery with trucks, not required to be electric, not required to be compliant with a variety of things that could help protect the communities that they're moving through. Again, it's the elderly, it's the very young, it's the people with the pre-existing respiratory conditions and heart conditions. It's these same people in these neighborhoods that are affected. And this is why when we work in these neighborhoods, we see very high rates of asthma, emphysema, cardiac conditions and so forth. And these are the things that are arising as a result of the concentration of the pollutants being exacerbated by the heat that is concentrating this these pollutants down close to the earth. So we have to advocate for clean air. And we have to advocate for clean air in ways that help the people who live here. You see the way that we have a federal road, we have county roads, and we have state roads all around, over, and through a community. So this is one of the communities that UUJF is working with in concert with the UU Service Committee. And I'd like you to get an understanding of what they are dealing with.
You won't find Eva Womack's children at this playground in Griffin Park.
They definitely stopped going to the playground locally because they was getting congested and sick from being out there.
No, she's not talking about the coronavirus, but a concern many Black communities in Orlando can't seem to shake.
It's definitely an environmental concern.
Poor air quality to start. Eva says for 3 years, she and her family have called Griffin Park home. And throughout that time, she believes the environment in the surrounding area is having a lasting impact on her children.
I just wonder if they're going to have breathing issues later in life, as well as health problems due to this situation.
A situation and problem that dates back to the 1800s. That's according to a study conducted by the Coalition for 100 Black Women of Central Florida, the group hoping to help families like Womack's through a $120,000 environmental grant.
Money from this EPA grant will go towards educating people who live in Black communities like Griffin Park about environmental concerns. Concerns like air quality, a big issue here in Griffin Park that has been impacted by cars driving on the nearby interstate.
And Griffin Park was surrounded by the 408, the off-ramps, and I-4. So the entire community had gas emissions coming off into the community. That is a hazard.
Coalition for 100 Black Women Central Florida President LaWanna Gelzer is heading up the EPA grant project. An EPA study reveals that minority and poor communities are disproportionately impacted by air pollution, with African Americans facing the highest impact with a 54% higher health burden compared to the overall population. Gelzer is hopeful this grant will change that percentage.
It's a three-part grant. The first part is education, telling everybody what we're going to do.
The EPA grant covers three Orlando communities, Paramore, Holden Heights, and Mercy Drive. Gelzer says the grant will also provide resources to study the prevalence of asthma and other respiratory diseases. The group will also be partnering with UCF to install solar-powered air quality sensors to monitor air quality. Eva Womack says this is a step in the right direction, correcting the problems of the past to make way for a better future.
But I hope it changes one day.
In Orlando, Curtis McLeod, Spectra, News 13.
So we are working in this community with LaWanna Gelzer, and we have completed the first survey that we have done to be able to establish the levels of asthma, the levels of concern about respiratory symptoms people are having. This is the kind of imagery that's coming out of the community. They are calling this is an environmental justice grant, and what UUJF's role in this is that we provide technical assistance so that they can satisfy all of the federal requirements for them to be able to obtain the grant. And then we're also providing the analysis on the surveys. They have people within the community who are able to lead their citizen science field team. And they have people within the community that we are developing and training so that they can have the capacity to do more on their own when this two-year project is finished. They frame this as community equity project, and that the climate crisis is a health crisis in their community. They have a youth group that is working on community impact projects, and they're calling their young people youth environmental equity ambassadors. And UUSC is also helping us, as is the UU College of Social Justice, to be able to make internships available so that young people, college age people in college, new college graduates can help get leadership training so that within their own community, they can raise up the stories that they want to tell about what it is like to live under those conditions. And so there are, and I'm not going to take the time to show you this, but this is, there are extreme damage to the lungs and to, you know, the coronary artery system that can happen as a result of living in a polluted environment over time. I will put the link to this presentation in the chat when I'm finished. But that leads to things. This woman, Latoya, this group came up with a climate action plan. This was part of their process where they were doing asset and liability mapping where they met. And they came up with a climate action plan. They dedicated their climate action plan to Ms. Latoya Jackson, who passed away shortly after having an interview with the Huffington Post. She lived across the street from a Superfund site in the community that was putting out volatile organic compounds into the air. There's not a health disparity study because the city would not pay for it. The city was considered to be a possible one of several responsible parties, and the need for a health disparity study has been moved several years into the future. So some of the things that we are seeing in our frontline communities are related to flooding. And there are basically three kinds of flooding that we're seeing in frontline communities: sea level rise, flash flooding, and more intense hurricanes. So in the sea level rise area, the speed at which the sea level is rising has increased, and now it's rising as much as an inch every 3 years. So places where it did not used to flood are now flooding. So if we take a look at, I'm wondering why they won't move, there it moved. If we look at the greenhouse gas concentration, adding to these various issues, the reduced air quality, the heat waves. Now we're talking about the variable and more extremes in precipitation and the sea level rise. And as you can see, the sea level rise projections over time, which is what these are quite variable, and a lot depends on what we do. So what we have here is the IPCC, the International Panel on Climate Change, has its particular line, and we have other entities and NOAA. So NOAA has this very high projection of what will happen with sea level rise in the future. And then we have the more moderate projections that you see. And then USAS, they're saying if we do many things, perhaps it will not be quite as much. But what the effect that sea level rise has, I'll show you a community that I worked in. In this community, this is the group I worked with was living in this housing, group housing. This is in Miami in the lowest lying area called Shorecrest. And this is during high tide, or what they're calling the king tides, when the planets are aligned. It's the worst high tides of the year. And this Section 8 housing is not something that is visible because of the way people look statistically at data. They are, Biscayne Bay is back on a couple blocks here, and there's very expensive housing. So if you have very expensive housing two blocks from you, and people are looking for where is the vulnerability, they are not finding you if you are a Section 8 unit that's very close, because the data gets aggregated, it's all together, it's averaged out. And so these folks who are living in this apartment have a very hard time making it understood that there are low income people of color suffering from the actual sea level rise. And one of the outgrowths of sea level rise is often contaminated water. And so in the area that I just showed you, they were concerned about coliform. I have here one of the things that's very important for us to understand when we think about equity, and we think about NIMBY, and we think about all the wonderful things that we have that are very useful for us. This is actually an area that keeps all of the bins in the downtown Orlando area that need to be repaired or looked at in some way that are for either recycling or for, you know, dumpsters for trash. I used to think that recycling was so clean until I began to work with the residents living with their, these are houses right back behind it. And when it rains or when there are hurricanes, they have an exodus of rats and bugs that come from this particular site that's right next to their housing. So we have to worry whenever we have, and certainly any of those of us living, you know, with hurricanes as you have, that there may be toxic chemicals or raw sewage that is coming, particularly when you have, you know, the clay pipes that are very, very old, and we have to be concerned about bacteria in those waters. So one of the things that we did in the community that I just showed you is to work with the residents there and to give them the knowledge of how to check for coliform in the water, which is what this person is doing here. And this person is recording and taking a picture of the label on this sample so that they can find out and they can map where is it that there is bacteria to be avoided when they have flooding. And what they were able to do, and we were able to teach them how to make these maps and be able to understand what's happening there. This is the point of entry that they were having for the bacteria, for the coliform, and it was spreading down the street and they were picking it up to this point. And then there was a storm drain that was bubbling up right next to a manhole over here that also had coliform. So if we cannot get the funding for the infrastructure to be addressed, which we still have to fight for at every turn in these communities where there are not real investments being made, then we certainly need to help people figure out how they can protect their health by changing where they might walk or go during times when there are pollutants or, you know, other kinds of toxins in the water. And so this is about dignity. This is about supporting the worth and dignity of every individual. And I just wanted to show you the faces of some people that we tried to get boots for these people. We actually worked with organizers who were sending out national level talking points, and we tried to get them to help fund being able to get boots to these people who experienced a great deal of flooding, and it was in their parking lot and they couldn't take their trash out, and their trash was beginning to be piled up in their apartments because they didn't and couldn't afford boots. Sometimes dignity is about boots. And these people, we were able to fund with boots. So the flash flooding comes up very quickly when infrastructure is overwhelmed. In much of Florida, we have very old infrastructure that really has not had an investment. And much of that is in low-income areas. And so there are car accidents, drowning, injury, lacerations, and electrocution, things that can occur as a result of that flash flooding. And I just want to give you an idea of what that looks like. This is in one of our low-income communities of color in Central Florida, where the flash flooding came up very quickly, and people had to be evacuated by the National Guard. So this is an infrastructure issue. Since this time, this is also a piece of the data that was an aberration. The data was not showing the risk level that was appropriate for this area. So this particular area was never put on the list to have the infrastructure upgrades until after this event, after Hurricane Irma. And advocates and people like us help amplify that voice to get this work done. And people need to be on notice to help amplify the messaging that these things need to be changed, because when the water subsides, people say, oh, well, you know, it was a one-time thing. But unfortunately, these things are getting worse and worse with time. And then we have, as a result of the flooding, we have impacts of mold, we have impacts of fungus. And again, with the respiratory problems, the skin irritations, and this can lead to liver problems, wound infection, headaches, Legionnaire's disease. This is people. This is people. And this is people that we look at and we don't think they're having any more difficulty than we are. And then when you ask the people who showed up at the meeting about dealing with these conditions, and you ask how many of them have asthma, and 2/3 of the room raises their hand, you understand it's a disproportionate impact. So the indoor mold often has to be dealt with professionally if it's the black mold, and you really need to get that professionally evaluated. Many people don't have the money for that. We sometimes try to help people not only with damp rids so that they can immediately have it to cut down on the moisture, but also to help them in any way we can to attach them to the professionals who can check to see if they have mold, black mold in their HVAC system, in any of their appliances, or God forbid, in their drywall. So in Panama City and Bay County, we're working with LEED Coalition as our primary wonderful people that we mentor and assist, and they are conveners of others. You all have been active with them in the past and hopefully will be continuing into the future. I want to talk to you about the EPA Environmental Justice Grant that we are working on in Panama City. When COVID began, and this is an effort through Resilient American Communities, and I can show you this in more detail in just a moment, to have a presence in the community working on COVID, currently working on vaccine equity, and to really help with COVID. I will tell you that COVID is directly linked to negative outcomes in terms of mortality in those communities with high levels of particulate matter. And so that would be people who perhaps are living near an industrial source where there's more of that being put off, or high traffic, and that particulate matter that's coming out of exhaust, the diesel particulates and so forth. If there is a 1 microgram per meter cube increase in the concentration of particulate matter, very small particulate matter, 2.5 microns, there is an 8-fold increase in mortality. And it's because of the damage done to the lungs over time of the people who live in those communities. So they're very, very vulnerable to negative outcomes from COVID. So this was an effort in June we did a needs assessment the technology, the understanding of how to do mapping at the same time that you're gathering information by using apps on the cell phone was something that we taught and worked with people. And in Millville, in Glenwood, and in St. Andrews the Hill. And at that time, the partners were Rebuild Bay, LEED, the Bay County Emergency Services, the Florida Health Department assisted with literature, the Minority Chamber, J.D. Green's Education Services, and the LGBTQ Center. I believe that you all had some folks who helped by taking the surveys that were living in the geographies that we were working in, and helped to push out some of those surveys. And one of the things that's moving forward, okay, so there were many things that we were looking at, and many of them were related to COVID. And so I'll just tell you that this piece of things was done to support what was found in those surveys, which was cooperating with these mobile food giveaways, because what we found in the assessments were that people only had 2 weeks worth of money to live on if they lost their jobs at most. And so the need became clear, and the group that was smaller and growing at that time decided to move in that direction. Part of this information that we gathered in these communities is meant to support the work of looking at the indoor air quality issues of places that have not yet recovered from Hurricane Michael and may have volatile organic compounds. They have formaldehyde in particular leaching from their drywall. And may have particulate matter in their homes at high levels. And so as part of that survey, we got information on 35 households, some of them are hiding behind these other icons, but the green were the ones who said that they were concerned for themselves or for others regarding health impacts from air quality in their home. And then those who said that they were concerned that they had air quality issues in their homes. And so now we had to have an extension because of COVID. A piece of this was taking the protocol that we were going to have to do home assessments and have people go into people's homes to do self-assessments that we can help guide and train people to do regarding checking to see all sources within their homes that may still be remaining, that may be contributing to their concerns of air quality, but then also to monitor, to provide monitors to them in their homes and teaching them how to read the air quality monitors and how to record that data. And then we will be moving through the process of determining what are some of the issues and what are the best ways to communicate to the public those resources that may be available to deal with them. So that remains on that project. So I do wanna talk about where we're moving. So I just wanna take you on a trajectory of a very quick trajectory of time of how we talk about climate change. Initially, people are saying it's all about the numbers and it's all about the science. You need to understand greenhouse gases. You need to understand the air pollution. You need to understand where we're going with this. And then it moved into engineering issues. Now we have to take care of infrastructure. Now we have to take care of the insurance that's paying for the problems from the hurricanes that we're having that are stronger. And now we're at the place where we're saying it's about the health disparities. And if one thing COVID did was it pointed out the health disparities that we have in our country. So I'm going to talk to you in a moment about some of the things we need to support and look at in general, but I do want to show you a little bit of the work that's being done in Bay County regarding the COVID, which is intimately related to social determinants of health, like housing, social determinants of health, like working on, you know, everybody having, you know, food access, not just access, but also to nutritious foods and the other social determinants of health that we see disproportionately weak in these communities. So this group does a weekly data update supported by students that are working as data stewards. They are doing weekly updates on what's going on in the Bay District schools. And they have done a good bit of research, and that research has shown that there are certain zip codes where the COVID is higher in 32404, 32405, 32444, and 32401. And then they've concentrated a lot of efforts. When we come down here, I'm just gonna take you down and show you. When we look within the zip codes at areas with the high minority populations and the low median incomes, what we're seeing is more COVID. So when we are looking at these profiles of certain census block groups, the averaged data falls away. And what we see is that the concentration of the problems are often in these very small geographic areas that we can focus on. So this group has done a lot of work in not only working on addressing those areas, getting them information, providing them with COVID kits. But just so that we understand what we're talking about, I'll just quickly show you one of the things that we have helped them so that they can have these kinds of things on their webpage, is that this is a social vulnerability index that goes from 0 to 1 that the CDC uses when it looks at the social determinants of health. And what we see are in the red, these are in the top quartile. They have numbers like 0.9541, and the estimated minority population is 75.5%. In this area, they have very low percent of limited English, but 2.7% of the folks are in crowded conditions, more people than there are rooms in their homes. And like 12.6% of them are uninsured. And so this holds in this area. We start seeing 18.9% of the people are uninsured. and we start seeing 22.2% are uninsured. And so as we look at this data, the people that were working in coalition decided to offer home COVID healthcare kits that have pulse oximeters in them that can measure the amount of oxygen that they have so that they can monitor it and know if they need to go get healthcare, and that also how to take care of themselves at home. So to give them that kind of support is something that's being worked on, and of course a number of other things. But I wanted to show you that in addition to providing those things that are the authoritative information, there is the ability to do surveys in a HIPAA compliant environment so that if there is a need to collect medical information, they can do so in surveys that they click through. And then also to let you know that a big piece of what's been done here is to go into the community. We did, I think, 738 surveys in that effort. And I believe you all helped contribute to that effort. And what we found was, and we have this by zip code and by census tract, and they can look at it by census block group, which is much smaller. The complaints, the concerns that were the strongest were for the agricultural sector. There is no feeling that there is a sustainability with food. Much of the food that's coming in for the giveaways is coming from outside, from USDA. And there are even problems storing enough food for any period of time. So there's a feeling that was came through about the need to grow local, the environmental health and safety piece, the psychosocial resilience piece, and the housing safety piece were the top four in the kind of work that they did. And then by providing this sort of data, having done this sort of work, it enables the leaders to be able to do some grant writing that's based on facts that shows the capacity of having done that work. So we've supported that endeavor. And then there are things that I just wanted to show you that were important. This is what I was explaining about the question, how many weeks could you financially sustain your household if your workplace closed and you received no additional pay? 0 weeks was 26%. The 3 to 4 weeks was 19%. 1 to 2 weeks was the largest group at 44%. And that's what precipitated working at the food distribution events. I did want to let you just show you, they were tracking the cases by zip code. The darker area here are the areas with the most COVID. Although these are the lead organizations, there are many others that have come in. And many of the Black churches have joined in this effort. And so it goes. So I just want to take you back and just tell you the kinds of things that we want to be able to concentrate on and think about. And that is legislation that's about health disparities, requiring the immediate health impact studies funded by whoever is identified as a responsible party, where these environmental toxins are released in communities. They can put it off now. It can go quite a long time. We want to support legislation that addresses the health disparities. This just passed, we were supporting this. It required a minority health liaison in each county health department to be able to message and make sure that messages were getting through to the minority communities that were accurate, that were working against myths that were being spread. This is just to show you that in the area that has a Superfund site, and it has, these are brownfield areas and all of these pollutants, this is where we're working in Central Florida, where you saw the picture with all of the traffic. And it's about holding these people accountable who have having these spills and dumps and whatnot to get them to clean it up. The yellows are being cleaned up. The greens are close to being cleaned up or almost retired. And so we want to move them on that trajectory. We have to advocate for upgrades in stormwater management systems, not just in the wealthy neighborhoods, but everywhere, because we don't want to see more of this. This is happening in Central Florida in that community that I showed you of Orlo Vista. And then finally, just locally, if you sign up, and some of you already are, and we enjoyed hearing presentations from your congregation at UUJF's last legislative days before COVID really changed the way we're experiencing life. If you sign up for the UUJF action alerts, you can get those alerts on Florida bills that are precinct specific. If you give your full number of digits on your zip code, David Johnson is doing a really great job at that. The EPA Environmental Justice Grant is going to be, we had to, as I said, take an extension. There will be work on that. If any of you want to be engaged, that's with LEED Coalition. And so we are monitoring those homes. I don't know if you know Tony Bostic. He is doing the outreach for these things, and he may need some help, but we're gonna be training the people to be able to do their self-assessments and training them to monitor for those compounds. And then after that, we're gonna have community forums, and there may be some support needed for that because we want to take a look at those monitoring results, see what people still have in their homes, and move from the data to action, and with a communications plan, with the understanding of what support is available for people. And then finally, there is the effort Rebuild Bay is spearheading and is working with the CRA, with Michael Johnson, on supporting the development of the A.D. Harris Learning Village and Community Resilience Center. And that facility is older, as we know, and it will not be cheap to harden it. And that's something that all eyeballs need to be on, because it is a real beacon of hope, of a way of being able to work on health disparities and being able to work on disparities and inequities of all kinds. So I'd like to leave it there, kind of in your backyard, and I'm looking forward to speaking with you all later. Thank you.
Thank you, Jan. Wow, that was awesome. Such great data and content. It's a lot to let sink in. But I really appreciate all the work you're doing around the state and in our community. Jan will also be joining us this afternoon, right after the service, for Coffee Talk. If you'd like it to join us for any follow-up questions or comments, please do join us. I've also added her contact information in the chat. And we look forward to talking to you more about that. So as we take a minute to digest the engaging service from our speaker, please let's join in the next musical element from the UU Ministry of Earth. A hymn you probably know well. It's Earth Was Given a Garden, but this version is performed as an instrumental by trumpeter John Olin. The trumpet is one of my favorite instruments, so I hope you enjoy it as much as I did enjoy Earth Is Given a Garden. Hope you enjoyed that. I found our closing words for the reflection from a reflection by Reverend Jeannie Lloyd from 2007. And it's titled Spirit of Life and Energy, that I felt really connects our topic today with where we go from here. Spirit of light and energy, how shall we live these precious moments of life? What would you have us know? And the spirit of humanity says, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. I say, so simple, of course, but what else? Is that all? And the spirit says, is that all, you say? Is that all? Do you see yourself in others' eyes? If you do, you cannot stand still. You must not distract yourself with the busyness of life and thereby fail to bring purpose and meaning to your own life. You cannot choose to separate yourself from the people. There is no place for disconnection from this precious, fragile world, except by choice. And the spirit asks again, do you see yourself in others' eyes? And if you do, you will grow and learn and be changed by others who seem different, but whose eyes are like yours, whose eyes show an inner soul, show an inner light and spirit like yours. If you do, their right to dignity becomes your right to dignity. Their need becomes your need. Their need for change becomes your need for change. Their back against the wall place becomes your back against the wall place. A place where nevertheless, still you have a choice. The choice to lend your will, your heart, strength, and power to actively resist barely visible systems of oppression. It is your choice, your doing to decide whether you will choose to struggle free of systems that count on the probability that you will allow things to go on just as they always have, lured by distraction from the true course and meaning of your life. And the spirit asks again, do you see yourself in others' eyes? If you do, you will cultivate the power of an expanding heart that ministers to and receives the ministry of shared justice work with others. A life of ministry where you can no longer resist the call. Though it may be easier and saner to do so. This is the time. You are called forth to an expanded vision of ministry in the larger word because it is the morally correct thing to do. You are called to live your life to its highest principles. You are called to make sacrifices. You are called to change your way of being in order that others may live justly. And the spirit asks, do you see yourself in others' eyes? Are you willing to lose your life so you may save it? And I say, but this is hard work. This is too much risk. I may lose too much. And the spirit says, acts of love and compassion for one another are the only ways to find and redeem your true self. This is your life's call. And so the question you must answer is, do you see yourself in others' eyes? And if the answer is yes, please say, I do. I do. And I invite you to share your I do affirmation in the chat or the comments. Now we'll turn it back over to Janet as we extinguish our chalice. Janet?
Okay, it is our work shared with each other in covenant that creates and sustains this beloved community. We extinguish this chalice, but its light lives on in the directions we have chosen today. The light of this faith lives on in us together, in our hearts, minds, bodies, and spirits. Amen and blessed be.
Thank you, Janet. And thank you all for joining us this morning. And special thank you to our speaker, Jan Boer, for sharing her time and talents with us on such an important issue. Our congregation has a proud history of social justice action, and we know that your compassionate hearts will open to the deep connection between social justice and climate justice. We hope that that connection has been made clearer and stronger for you this morning. And if you'd like to get more involved, Janet invites you to reach out to her for more information on her initiatives, and I've shared her contact information in the chat. To learn more about our social justice initiatives or our congregation, please, we invite you to join us online at uuofbaycounty.com, where you'll learn more about Unitarian Universalism and our fellowship. Let me see where we're at. We're going to close our service today with another UU Ministry of Earth's virtual choir singing anthem, Hallelujah for the Earth. This is another musical piece that was created specifically for congregations to share during their Earth Day celebration. And remember, if you're so moved, you can contribute to the UU Ministry for Earth at uumfe.org. I hope you enjoyed our time together today. Have a wonderful week ahead, and we hope to see you next Sunday at 10:30 when we welcome back our friend, Reverend Tiffany Sapp. Coffee Talk will begin after this last hymn here on Zoom, and I hope you enjoy it. Have a great day. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I have stopped the Facebook Live, so you're welcome to turn your mics on and join us for the chat. Thank you so much, Jan. We really appreciate you being here this morning.
Thank you.
I was reading some of the comments on Facebook, too. They were such great content and data and connections to so much more important things than just it's flooding, you know, the connection it makes to the human level on the human level. It's awesome.
Great service. Both of you did such a good job, Jan and Charissa. I really